Welcome to another show of Reality Change with Kris. We had a great show last time, folks. It was great, wasn't it? It was the Q&A. If anybody hasn't seen that show, go to YouTube and check it out. I think it's well worth listening or watching. But today's show is, well, we're not quite sure exactly what it's going to be about. As usual, we're going to invite Kris to join us and take us wherever he wants to take us, basically. How are you today, Serge?
Much better.
Yeah, we had a session last night at the Argo Books, which will be on available to hear, the audio. Very, very interesting session called The Zen of Channeling. And I learned, I mean, you know, I've been sitting around for 10 years, but there was stuff there I'd never heard before. It was a good session.
Yeah, unfortunately, the first little while is marred by my hacking, but eventually goes away when Kris shows up, which was nice.
Yes, he gave an amazing presentation all about how that stuff works and the kind of things that he's doing when he's not channeling here, you know, like channeling through you. He's a busy boy or girl or whatever he is.
Busy it.
A busy it. So, we've got the introductions done. I'm John Hawkins. This is Serge Granbois. And we're going to be joined very shortly by Kris.
Now we trust that you are comfortable.
Thank you.
And we thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Kris.
Yesterday evening's presentation was most enjoyable for a variety of reasons. And we would like to continue simply sharing some tidbits and insights into some of the processes involved with our communication through Joseph.
Wonderful.
In case any one of you are wondering, Joseph is our friend here who has so kindly made the necessary arrangements to enable an exchange between his personality and our own personality, creating a blend of sorts that allows for the communication to occur. Now, quite some time back, many years ago, as we began the process of this communication with Joseph, and once the practices were in place, once the systems was established, that these communications can occur. It is necessary at some point to establish a firm foothold. And in order to do that, Joseph had to expand his own awareness, his own consciousness, stretch the boundaries of his worldviews. Because his references were rather narrow and singular in terms of what he understood concerning the channeling phenomenon, as is many people's understanding. So in order to facilitate this exchange or transfer, he allowed us to insert a particular, we do not want to use the word app or application or program. But it is appropriate as well. Mm-hmm. And piece of technology, if you like, but it is not physical, of course, into his persona. Such that once that switch is flipped or triggered, then the exchange occurs rather rapidly. And this enables then for the exchange to occur rather quickly. And it allows us to also send information. So it is like a subconscious cache, if you like. And kind of psychological secondary hard drive or backup system.
Well, you know, he does sometimes talk about receiving downloads from you.
Indeed. And we facilitate that quite often. There are times when the information is pertinent to a particular subject matter he is pondering. There are times when we facilitate a quote-unquote download of information that has nothing to do with what we may be speaking about presently or at some future time, but is more pertinent to some living situation, either of his, or perhaps information that can be translated at some future time. And that may again be pertinent to what we present or he deals with. So there are many different layers in this cache. It is, if you like, a particular kind of psychological library. But it is of the highest technological order, in a manner of speaking. Because everything is sorted in a variety of ways, much like when you put tags on these recordings.
Right.
So these particular downloads have their own unique kind of tags, which can be quickly sorted by a portion of his consciousness that is now accustomed to enabling this, looking through various files at ultra-rapid speed. Like looking through a filing cabinet. Joseph has often spoken in the past of having the sensation as if a particular filing cabinet is being looked through very rapidly, looking for specific information. So this is how the process is established in his consciousness. It works for our kind of arrangement. We often do not have to be present, in your terms, in his blended experience, in order to deliver information.
Oh, that's interesting. Oh, you're sometimes not present.
That is correct.
He's running, in a sense, a program that he received.
Indeed.
Oh, that's interesting.
And there are times when we do step in, so to speak, in order to reorganize the information in conjunction with the request for information.
Yeah.
So since we are aware of simultaneous flows of time, all occurring in a manner quite or in a manner that you would find quite haphazard and even disorienting. For us, for our purposes, time is something that can be played with. For you, time is a very fixed experience. It flows from past to present and potential future.
Time waits for no man.
Indeed. Or woman, for that matter. Let us be of equal opportunity.
Yes.
But from another perspective, from our perspective, time is quite malleable. Even yourselves, when you enter deep dream states and you end up visiting these so-called past lives, you do not quite capture just how you manipulate time to make necessary changes or adjustments ever so slightly in order to ratify some past life experiences, in order to garner knowledge or wisdom for your present situation. All of these so-called past life experiences are also not fixed in the same way you believe they are. They are not concrete nor static. They also continue to flow and alter and change. So you can visit some so-called past life experience and have a certain influence affect certain outcomes that may not specifically have occurred otherwise. It is not altering the timeline as your science fiction novels often speak about, and therefore cause the destruction of the universe simply because you sneezed at the wrong moment. It does not work in that manner. Time is bendable, is flexible, like the flow of a river in its bedstream. It flows in and around and through rocks and pieces of wood and other formations, around curves and so on and so forth. So time is much more malleable than you have ever thought possible. And because you believe so strongly in the rigidity of time, you are bound then by your own beliefs to act in a certain manner that often ends up with you having to believe that you are the victim of events from the past, even past lives.
Right.
So you have much more flexibility and the possibility of different outcomes. Now, we're not saying that you can go back in time and change the entire course of a life, but you can provide alternatives. You can influence certain effects that would color it differently without destroying those particular adventures, because they need to continue their own explorations. You're adding spice to the mix.
And sometimes a little experiment to see how it turns out. It's like a living library of alternatives that you can go in and tinker with.
Indeed. Or like computer programs. Do forgive us, Michael, for this analogy again. But when you play certain games, an expert hacker might be able to go through into the game's programming and insert certain changes, different hues, different colors, different backgrounds, different situations, different outcomes to flavor the whole production in a manner that adds buoyancy, vitality, exuberance, and so on and so forth. Does that make sense to you? So you all have this potential, but you do not often use it. You instead play the role of the woe is me individual.
The victim.
Indeed. And it is played sometimes to quite an extreme, given your race's propensity for those kinds of dramatizations. You firmly believe in the inherent, innate violence of your species in such a manner that you find it difficult to move past that. But that is part of your programming. So you can become your own psychological hackers. per se, and make changes to your own personal belief structures.
Insert a little.
Indeed. You are not fated to continue destroying yourselves or to continue destroying the world as you know it. That is the projection of your own beliefs. You believe so firmly in the iniquity of your species that you sometimes wish your own species would be damned because of what you think are the atrocities you perpetuate upon life, upon the environment, upon nature, upon yourselves. Does that make sense?
Well, it's a little bit horrifying, but I think it's true. It is true.
And then you look at some situations being played out in the world and say, here is the proof of our inherent evil, how we kill for the sake of killing, for the sake of controlling others and instilling beliefs upon others. But that is only because you use one set of eyes and not another.
Yeah, that's not the proof of our nature, that's the proof of our beliefs.
Indeed. It is being projected outwardly for you to see and realize that there is a possibility that if you are the ones that are collectively and singularly projecting this, then perhaps you can do something with the source of that projection and create a different outcome. So this is something to ponder, and ponder deeply, because you have all of the tools. You use them every day, but you use them to your disadvantage. Whom wants to be born into a world that is full of color and vitality and an entire spectrum of experiences to choose from? All of you. All of you. Because that is why you're here. You're not here only for the experience. Because once you put on a pair of socks, then you have done the experience. Why do it 10,000 times over? So you are here for more than just the experience. You are here to discover that you have the abilities and the potential to make profound changes about the nature of the reality you experience, collectively and singularly.
That's wonderful.
So do take this into consideration. That is why we often thank you for your consideration. It is something that you can ponder and actually use. And changing your personal beliefs is not that difficult.
Ooh, tell me about that.
First and foremost, you believe that your experiences are the way they are, you are the way you are, and there is nothing to do about it.
Right, so you're stuck there already.
Indeed. So already you put the most difficult block in your own path. If you understand the very basic premise, and this is not difficult, that two individuals in the same situation can see something entirely different, indicates that it is not the event, but the perceiver of the event that is important.
Reality is in the eye of the beholder.
And it always is, always will be, and it always has been that way. Many of the ancient sages from ages past developed the wisdom to perceive this. Their teachings have, over time, been altered and changed to suit the moods and the times and circumstances, sometimes to the point where those teachings are so distorted, it has simply become and other religion. Something that is used then to control the people. You have so many other means, even your own experience can teach you that the experience and the perceiver are two different things. And the perceiver is the important, the number one important. The perceiver perceives his experience, observes, and is asked to make an observation. But instead, you have been trained to make a judgment. An observation and a judgment are two different things. You consider something good or something bad. That, unfortunately, develops a whole mess of duplicitous concepts, because you carry them further and further away from the truth of yourselves. So you become somewhat disoriented, ultimately. And you forget that reality and time and space are malleable. They are not as concrete as you believe it to be. So that very first thing, the perceiver, is important. The perceiver determines what he or she will take away from the experience.
Well, that brings a question up. I mean, I appreciate very much the description of how to start going about changing your own beliefs. And I love the idea that it's not that hard. We were talking about other lifetimes, let's say past, future, other focuses. Can we, let's say our own past, let's say our childhood, can we go back to our own childhood and change the outcome of an experience by altering our present perception of it?
The possibility exists to revisit your own growing up experiences. Now, you may not be able to prevent something from happening. However, you can come to a different observation about a particular event or circumstance that occurred in your quote-unquote past. So if you have gotten to the point where you are an avid practitioner of victimhood, if you have now qualified for a PhD in victimhood,
right,
if you have graduated that far, then you will look at all your childhood experiences only through that lens. It becomes then a unidimensional perception. You only see all the times, and you will even create other situations where, of course, even something that was nourishing, enriching, beautiful, you might be tempted to turn it into a situation that was as poisonous as all the other experiences. You will taint the whole thing, and you may not even realize what you're doing. And this is a common practice. If you are able to understand that you do not need to stay in that frame of mind, then you begin to understand that your observations, your judgments about a situation are really the cause of your difficulties. Your judgments, your observations, these are based on the beliefs that you hold. These are the challenges, not the situations, not other people. You could say, as some have pointed out, that in a manner of speaking, it is like holding a hot piece of coal in your hand and hoping the other person feels the pain. Let it go. But you have vested interest in holding on to all of these judgments because you believe it is what has formed your character, your personality, and all of these traits and characteristics are immutable. They cannot be altered or changed. So therefore, you somehow or other pray for a miracle of some sort. But the miracle exists in you and how you view or perceive perception, how all these things have been laid out before you and what you have judged on them. It is a simple, simple process. It is not filled with mysticism and mystery. You do not have to belong to some arcane metaphysical group for that.
And have a secret handshake.
Indeed not. Although a secret handshake could be fun. But know that you are different from all the thoughts and the beliefs that you entertain and that you hold as judgments against situations. But you become swept up in the situation. And that causes your undue suffering.
Mm-hmm. Well,
so we suggest a small break.
Very good.
Indeed.
Very good. We'll take a little break then. We're back. And as usual, we'd like to just talk a little bit about some announcements and just general information before we invite Kris back. The first thing I'd like to mention is that we have a sponsor for the show. And I just wanted to give a little shout out to Barbara, whose sponsorship is very much appreciated.
Yes, indeed, very nicely. Very, very kind on her part.
Mm-hmm. And other than that, I mean, we just did the Origo book last night, so we're going to do another one next month sometime, but there's lots of time to announce that on later shows. So I'm just going to quickly remind everybody that there is a YouTube channel called Reality Change with Kris, and that is where you'll find all of these shows. Secondly, there is a website called lotus-mind.ca, which is Kris's home on the internet, one of them. And we have,
excuse me,
is there a Lotus Mind website, a Lotus Mind Facebook?
On Facebook,
on
yeah.
On Facebook, yeah.
Yeah, lotus-mind.
.ca.
Yeah, on Facebook.
On Facebook.
Yeah.
So, there's lots of ways to get more Kris, if that's what you want. And I don't know what you folks feel, but I think that the first half of the show has been dynamite, and I'm looking forward to more. So let's invite Kris to join us again. Welcome back, Kris.
Indeed, we thank you again for your consideration.
And thank you.
Now, earlier on we mentioned about this sort of psychological program.
Yes.
That we introduced into Joseph's consciousness.
Right. Mm?
It is not that different from the DNA programs that exist in nature, such as the one that enables the caterpillar to begin building a cocoon, to turn into a chrysalis, and eventually to emerge as a butterfly. So it is the natural encoding that's also suffices for our purposes with Joseph. Mm-hmm. The propensity exists. We simply enhance that kind of programming. Mm-hmm. See, all of you have the potential to experience much more of yourselves as well as much more of the reality that you perceive and then interact with. But you are utilizing a small portion of that programming. It is embedded not only in your DNA, but in your own innate psychology, your personality structure. The traits and characteristics that make up who you think you are not unique to your present personality. They are traits that exist in all the various other lives that you have dispersed through time and space. But you assemble a certain assortment of these particular traits and characteristics to fuse together, if you like, and produce the personality that you are. This is done also in conjunction with all of the environmental factors that also help form the personality. Again, it is necessary to remember that you are always the perceiver and therefore the one that determines how you will create outcome through observation and judgment, depending on the situations you find yourself in. So remembering this very small fact that you are the perceiver, and that the experiences occur because of your desires in one way or another. And we understand no one would say, I never desired war. But you may have desired other things, some exciting, even dramatic outcomes. And because of your other beliefs associated with your species, war may seem like and proper, acceptable outcome, even though consciously you would rail against such a notion. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Oh yeah, for sure. That happens, I think, in common everyday experiences, where, for instance, to take the example of a man or a woman who have partners, who have serial partners, right? One after the other after the other. And they all have very similar traits and characteristics. And at a certain point, you begin to realize that what's common, the common element among all of these people who you're not comfortable with, is that you chose them.
Indeed. As you suggested, the common element is not the traits and characteristics that they display, but the traits and characteristics that you draw out of them.
Right.
Just as the traits and characteristics that you display, they draw from you.
Yeah, it's miraculous how that works.
These are invitations, and sometimes the invitation is best left closed. Sometimes you open it anyways. That also has to play in with what you desire as an outcome of your life. And this is going to be according to the beliefs you hold about these things. These are the foundations of your experiences, the beliefs that you hold. And when collectively you still maintain a certain accommodation for your species' so-called inherent traits of violence and murder and deceit and destruction, then these will, in one way or another, be displayed in your experiences. Mm-hmm. If you recognized the seeds of those desires and therefore the beliefs that grow out of these seeds, you can end up with an experience very different than the one you now have and the one your species has had for thousands of years now.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a change is coming.
It takes time, but it will occur. You have to give yourselves time. You have to give yourselves space in order to contemplate, consider what it is that you want from experience, from life. When you focus more so on the destructive qualities of your species, you are not, in any sense of the word, concentrating upon the other traits of your species. Mm-hmm. You, not you personally, not many of you, but collectively, many of you are extremely worried about the destructive factors that are brought about by the human race upon nature. Mm-hmm. But if instead you considered other nurturing qualities that are also apparent in your species and nurtured those qualities instead, again, the outcome would be different.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that. Because when you say the belief in the savagery and the barbarism of the human species, we also have a belief in the grace and beauty and tenderness and compassion of the human species. Those are real beliefs.
Indeed. They are as cogent as any other. They're not focused upon.
Exactly.
You immediately point out to some devastation here there and say, see, there is the proof that as a species we are evil and destructive. And therefore, our species warrants elimination. And there are people who would gladly state, yes, our species needs to be wiped out.
You know, on that note, and in the idea of switching to a different focus, I remember coming across somebody's mother would tell this person, when there's a disaster, don't look at the disaster. Look at the first responders. Look at the people who are running towards the disaster to help. That's what's significant about disasters.
Indeed. As well as many other factors. Especially as an attempt to bring you to the realization that why do you bring this into your realities? What purpose does that serve? What purpose does illness serve as well as part of your human experience? All of these situations can indicate to you that since you do not like them, why do you keep repeating them?
Well, why do we?
Because you have not accepted the idea that you can change that collective programming. And it will not occur unless one individual begins, and another, and another, and another, and you create a true revolution of consciousness, that is the only place it will occur, in individual consciousness. Mm-hmm. As the momentum builds up then, you create an epidemic of change through consciousness. And the outcome is a completely different experience of the reality.
My feeling, my perception, is that exactly what you're describing is what's happening on this planet right now. I think that there's a groundswell of change in consciousness.
There is indeed. It begins with, how do we say, and small uprising, here, there, there. Not the kind where people lose control of their situation and cause rampant damage, because that is simply a reflection of the same old beliefs. Yeah. But each individual must come to an awakening. That is what this is all about. An awakening that you are not predetermined, predestined to live a life the way it has been dictated for thousands of years. You are destined to experience the changes you want or do not want in your life. Many of you claim you do not want war, and you will go to war to uphold that claim, and you will slaughter each other. We don't want war, therefore we will kill you. You do not want war, and you want to kill us. We will kill you too. It is a terrible game of badminton.
Oh, bless you.
Now, as we suggested, each individual must make that choice. That their regular old-fashioned judgments and condemnations of life, even their own brethren and all other life forms, can be stopped. It is said that you become the change you want to see in the world, but that is not enough. You must believe that this change is possible. Once you believe that, then the change appears. But often the change is only superficial, because you look for evidence to the contrary of that change all the time. You are scanning events, situations, people, activities, governments, this and that, and all over the place. And you say, it does not work, see? We still have the same dangers and the same damages. It requires a change of heart, a change of mind, a change of mindset, a change of worldview, literally a transformation. There is nothing in the butterfly that can remind you of the caterpillar. It is completely transformed from the inside out.
It's true.
You become lovely butterflies.
Wonderful. If you don't mind, I'd like to just bring forward something you mentioned last night at Origo Books that I found fascinating, and it relates a little bit to what you said here earlier, the idea that sometimes you're not present when Joseph is delivering a download. The idea that even when someone leaves this arena of the physical universe that we're in, they die, they leave their body, they go on to other adventures. But what they leave behind is a worldview.
Indeed.
And that's still a part of this material universe and various subtle levels. And the thing that I found fascinating is that that worldview is a living thing and it continues to evolve. I just find that fascinating.
Much like you can discover an ancient cave. Perhaps your ancestors from 40, 50, 100, 200, 1,000 years ago, a million years ago, may have lived in and left handprints and stone imprints, carvings in the stone, as a reminder to you that some ancestors passed here. So these living worldviews leave an imprint upon the living electromagnetic properties of reality. They imprint it with a particular notion of experience that can be used, tapped into, and becomes woven into and interwoven into the very fabric of time and space.
It becomes a resource.
And it is a tapestry of sorts. Much like your artists, Van Gogh, Gauguin, Da Vinci, and many ancient masters left all of these masterpieces. And you examine them today, and you look at the brush strokes, at the thicknesses of the oils and the pigments, how they were blended together, the shadows and the lights, and the imagery that is created. You are not struck only by the image, but by all of what went into it. Your subconscious picks it all up. And then you make some observation or comment. And it may leave an inspiration in you, perhaps about the majesty or the grace of life, the artistic qualities of human beings, and that perhaps there should be more of that. And then you leave. Then you may ponder it for days. You may even revisit it again, because it struck a chord within you. It imprinted something upon you. Mm-hmm. You are digesting this. And it may ever so subtly become part of your own life experience. Mm-hmm. So similarly, these worldviews are in themselves great works of art, but they are psychological in nature. Mm-hmm. And they continue to evolve in their own way. And as such, they leave an imprint, an inspiration for the rest of the race.
Yeah, for some reason
You often visit them, all of you. Often visit them in dream states. You think you are perhaps in a strange dreamland. You are visiting this place and that place. You have no idea that you are visiting a worldview. You see people milling about, dream people, dream creatures, dream dogs, dream cats, trees, all of these, the houses, villages, education centers, universities, workplaces, and so on, that have nothing much to do with your own life. But you may have just so easily ventured into a great work of art from another human being.
Which is their worldview.
Indeed. Their tableau.
Right.
Their masterpiece.
And I have a worldview.
Yes, and you may be visited by others because they admire your worldview.
Hey, it's a free country.
Indeed. So you see, there is a great open-ended gracefulness about life.
And a sharing.
And once you give yourself permission to move beyond your own limiting beliefs, you can experience all of these things and truly marvel at the gracefulness of life, how it can enrich who you are in ways you may not be able to fathom right now.
And since we're eternal, that's never going to stop.
It is always available to you. Mm. Always.
Well, I must say, I'm finding your material these last few times to be very rich. Has there been a change?
The change is in Joseph.
Ah, interesting.
Indeed. So with that, we will kindly take leave of your beautiful world views. Again, we thank Michael for his production assistance. And we thank you for your gracefulness. We thank Barbara for her subsidy. And we return Joseph to your good graces.
Thank you, Kris. Well, folks, that was a wonderful show. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. We're going to do this again a week from now. And meanwhile, thanks for watching and enjoy.
I had some, I don't know what to call them, like impressions, but like I was traveling in some big museums like the Louvre or something like that.
Really? Oh, he talked about art and worldviews. It was fascinating.